Hello everyone and welcome back to our channel Biodiversity and Conservation. I am Subbulakshmi Rao from Ambika Prasad Research Foundation India and we are continuing our series on UGC NET examination for environmental science subject, and this is 19th part of unit 3 environmental biology. Today we are going to study about species diversity. So ecological communities do not all contain the same number of species, and one of the active areas of research in community ecology is the study of species richness or diversity. So what is species diversity? It is an expression of community structure and is characteristically unique to community level of organization. And a community shows a high species diversity if many equally abundant species are present, and if a community is composed of only a few species, or if only a few species are abundant, then species diversity is low. High species diversity indicates complex community in which a high degree of species interaction is possible. And for this region reason, communities with higher diversities have higher levels of energy transfer between the food webs and cycle, higher levels of predation, competition, and niche availability. In several ecological community studies, species diversity has been constructed as a measure of community stability, in which low or changing species diversity may indicate a stressed or unstable environment. However, many ecologists argue that there is no direct correlation between species diversity and community stability or stress. So this says that we will find a high diversity of species in that type of community where there is high level of species interaction is present. That means there should be high amount of species for that interaction to become possible. So this normally says that if there is high level of very abundant species present in that community, then there will be predation, competition, and all that population interactions that will keep balance of these species in that environment. And next one is, what are the components of species diversity? This actually takes into account mainly three different ecological phenomena, that is species richness, relative abundance, and community evenness. So when they are viewed separately, each of these parameters reveal valuable ecological insight, and they provide an overall picture of the community structure. So first one is species richness. This is the first of the three parameters, and here we actually take into account the total number of species present in a community or its species richness. A high species richness indicates a complex community in which a high degree of species interaction is possible. So if there are high species interaction, that is like predation, competition, so there will be high levels of energy transfer, which indicates high species richness. Next one is relative abundance. This is the second parameter. which deals with the number of individuals within each species or the relative abundance of individuals within a given community. So if one accepts the theory that when species richness is high, then higher level of energy transfer is possible, then the idea that if within each species the number of individuals are also high, then higher levels of energy transfer within the community should be higher still. So in case of species richness, we dealt with the number of species or different species may be present in that condition, but here we are dealing with a same species but with higher number of individuals. If there will be higher number of individuals, then there will be higher levels of energy transfer within the community also, because it will increase the species abundance, which will in turn increase the species richness. Now the third parameter is community evenness, which relates to the evenness of the number of individuals within each species or its community evenness. So the communities that exhibit more even numbers of individuals within the total number of species present are thought to be closer to a state of equilibrium than those in which the number of individuals is less even, because the energy flow within ecological systems is constantly changing and consistent patterns of evenness within a given community can be equated with community stability. Now there are some ways to measure the species diversity, and those are species diversity indices. A large number of species diversity indices have been proposed and many are also in use, but the Shannon and Simpson indices are the two most widely used species in diversity indices for examining overall community characteristics. And so first one is Shannon-Wenner index. It is used to measure diversity in categorical data. It is based on the information theory approach. Like if we ask a question, how difficult would it be to predict correctly the species of the next individual collected from the community? So this uncertainty is measured by Shannon-Wenner function. So first one, second one is the Shannon's diversity index, where H dash is equal to minus summation of pi, logarithmic value of pi, where I, the lower limit is 1 and higher limit is S. And H is the information content of the sample or the index of species diversity, and S is the number of species or species richness, and N is the PI is the relative abundance of species, and this is calculated by the formula of Ni by N, where N is the capital N is the total number of individuals, that is the denominator, and the numerator Ni is the proportion of individuals of a given species. So next one is Simpson's diversity index. The formula is D is equal to 1 by, there are actually different methods to use the Simpson index, and this is the inverse method. So 1 by summation of pi square, where the lower limit I is equal to 1 and upper limit S, and here P is the proportion, small n by capital N, where N is the given species individuals and capital N is the total population of the species, and S is the number of species. So here in Simpson's diversity index, it takes into account the number of species present as well as the relative abundance of each species. And this was first proposed by British statistician Edward H. Simpson. And it represents the probability that the two randomly selected individuals in the habitat will belong to the same species. The simplicity of this index has led it to be used frequently. Now, there are some factors that affect the species diversity, like evolutionary time. This theory assumes that diversity increases with the age of a community. So, the temperate habitats are thus considered to be improvised with species. Because their component species have not had time enough to adapt to or occupy completely their environment. However, more mature tropical communities are more diverse because there has been a longer period without major disturbances for organisms to diversify within them. Next factor that affects the species diversity is ecological time. This theory is similar to evolutionary time theory, but it deals with a shorter or more recent time span. In evolutionary time, we take into reference about millions of years or thousands of years, but ecological time deals with recent time span, maybe 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, like that. And next one is climatic stability. This says that a stable climate is one that does not change much with the seasons. Environments with more constant climates allow finer speciation and narrower niches. For example, plants and animals in relatively constant tropics are often highly specialized in both the places they forage and the foods they eat. Next one is climatic predictability. Many aspects of climate, although temporarily variable, are nevertheless highly predictable in that they repeat themselves fairly exactly from day to day and year after year. Such cyclical predictability can allow organisms to evolve some degree of dependence, and it also helps to specialize on particular environmental conditions and temporal patterns of resource availability, thereby enhancing daily or seasonal replacement of species. And the next one is the spatial heterogeneity. Correlations between the structural complexity of a habitat and the species diversity of its biota are widespread. A forest contains more different species of birds than grassland. An arboreal desert generally supports more species of lizards than one without trees. So, where the habitat also, where the habitat is also changes the species diversity. So we will find different types of species in the forest ecosystem and in different in the desert ecosystem. So spatial heterogeneity is also a factor that affects the species diversity. Now, next one is productivity. In habitats with little food, the foraging animals cannot afford to bypass many potential prey. But when there is abundance amount of food in the ecosystem, the individuals can be more selective and they can choose their diet for better prey items. So the more productive habitats where the food is dense offer more prey choice and hence allow greater specialization than the less productive habitats. Now, the next factor is the stability of primary production. Just as more stable and more predictable climates support more species, areas with stable patterns of production should often allow the coexistence of more species. This says that if there is a stable amount of plant species in that population, so there will be maintenance of the primary consumers and secondary consumers. So this is also affects the species diversity. Next factor is competition. In many diverse communities, populations are thought to be often near their maximum sizes. So with the result that intraspecific and interspecific competitions are frequently keen. It says that for the maintenance of the communities, there should be healthy competition, that may be intraspecific or interspecific competition. This maintains the population size and keeps them stable. So selection for competitive ability is therefore strong, and most successful organisms in these communities have their own zone of competitive superiority. Thus, organisms that have specialized as to foods or habitats are at competitive advantage, and the resulting small niches make high diversity possible. Now, the next factor that affects the species diversity is disturbance. They can result in the continual density independent removal of organisms from a community. So disturbances may be like catastrophic winter or some natural calamities. These actually are very infrequent, and they either enhance the diversity or they reduce the diversity. So this can act in either way, maybe positive or negative. So next and last factor is predation. Predators can allow the local coexistence of species that are eliminated by competitive exclusion in the absence of the predator. So by either selective or random removal of individual prey organisms, predator can act as agents that reduce the level of competition among their prey. And because many predators prefer more abundant prey types, predation is often frequency dependent, which promotes the prey diversity. This is all from me today. Thank you.